Super. We'll stop it on our own like that. And dialogue on awakening. Okay, I have nothing better to do tonight than to tape, which is great. Great news for all of us because I can give a report. The previous video this morning is a wonderful. The grace of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's greater than expected. Wow. Okay. What a day. What a day of intensity. It got a little difficult, actually, as I thought it would. Now, this book, Dialogue on Awakening. Maybe you can read the spine there, Dialogue on Awakening. That's possible. There you go. Very interesting, because I had a dream in which clearly Longchenpa told me, don't even take refuge in this. Okay, and I thought, what? Because I'm wanting to take refuge in this. It was published in 1992. Well, that's quite a while ago. Especially the speed that everything's going right now. Right? Now, what is the rarest thing in this world? In fact, in any realm, is anyone, any situation, anyone at all focusing on the key, what is truly key? That almost never happens here. Almost never happens here. You can search for lifetime after lifetime and not see any trace of it. But we're doing that here. We absolutely know what is key here. However, we're in no hurry. We're in no particular hurry. It's kind of like a golfer who can hit it 360 yards if they use the driver. You know, they're in no hurry to hit it 360 because what is the hole call for? If it's a tight dog leg hole, they'll hit it like an iron off the tee or whatever. But they know when they get to that wide open hole, here comes the 360. Okay, so we're like that. I know the answer. I know, but when it's ready to come out, it will. Meanwhile, we are playing the course the way that it's laid out for us, right? So I read this book and I have it right near the computer and I open it up all the time and I just whenever I read it, read, and I get somewhat irritated. I always get a little bit irritated with Jesus from time to time. But I forgive myself. I say, well, that's just be expected. At least I'm considering what he has to say. And I'm saying, Jesus, you're being too abstract. I mean, it is just so difficult, actually, the level, the abstraction that you present. And it's like, how can we ever really accept this and experience it? Wow, it's so amazing. But later on, I'm always able to, you know, I say, well, you know, sure, there's a little friction and around this, but I'm honest with Jesus. I say, you know, I'm having a little trouble with this, and it's just frustrating. And then I'm reading some more, and I read some more, and read some more, and then something hits me that I had never quite seen before. And what hit me was something very different. And it was that he's saying too much. I always criticize Jesus for saying not enough. I say, Jesus, why don't you answer this? Why don't you answer this? Why are you so abstract? This. But now I suddenly, everything, the table suddenly flipped, and I said, wow, he's saying too much for where we're at right now. And very interesting that in June 4th, when he came to me in this dream, and I very consciously asked him to appear to me, and he appeared, and he didn't say anything. He didn't say anything. As if to say, okay, you're ready for me to say a lot less. And I understand that back when this was published, we needed to hear him address some of these issues. We felt, and especially in Course in Miracles, back when that was published, he said a lot more. But where we're at now, we're a lot more serious than we were back in 1992. Immeasurably so. Immeasurably more focused, actually. Because since 1992, we've had the you know, basically invasion by artificial intelligence. And really, the world's been taken over. We don't realize it. Most don't realize that, but it has been. And so we're like really, really serious now. and really, really focused. And it's been 25 years since this was published for me of all out intensive effort. Total intensive effort, 25 years, not to mention the 15 before that. So I realized I'm ready for Jesus to just focus in on what is absolutely key and forget about all this other stuff. Why? Because I had that experience of shifting my attention off, a simple shift of attention, an extremely simple shift of attention onto this one area, this one focus, and I experienced all regrets vanishing without a trace like they've never been, and I felt like I have never had any problem ever experienced the slightest trouble ever. That's how I felt. Imagine that. If you felt that you've never suffered, never had any trouble at all, that your experiencing has always been absolutely perfect, flawless. That's how I felt. And it was instantaneous. It was instantaneous. And then I had heard Padmasambhava saying, one insight settles it all. And then I realized that's exactly what he's talking about, Padmasambhava. And he's absolutely right. So then I'm saying to Jesus, I'm saying, hey, wait a minute, you know, why don't we just focus on this one insight and forget about all the other stuff? I mean, that doesn't matter at all, actually. Because once we shift our attention in the right direction, all regret vanishes and we feel that we don't have any questions at all. What about this? What about this? And to Jesus' credit, he consistently tries in this book to refocus our attention towards that one insight. But he also holds out an olive branch, you know, say, I don't want to advocate that I'm telling you you shouldn't do this or that. He realizes that back then we wanted to hear something about, you know, all these issues. And he didn't want to be too abstract and just say, I'm not really answering anything. Just put your attention here and everything, it's going to be fine. And we say, what are you talking about? You know, but now, at least for me, I'm ready for just this focus, just this focus, this simple shift of attention. That's all that's required, actually. Nothing more is required than that. So here we are. So Jesus was just quiet. He didn't say anything. Just sitting here quietly, waiting for me, like, are you ready to focus just on this one issue and forego everything else? And yeah, we're getting in the ballpark with that. Moving in that direction for sure, trending that way strongly. Because I realize all the other stuff is just a waste of time. It really is, which is frustrating. You read his answers here and you say, I still, something isn't quite right. Quite right. So one simple shift of attention, and it is truly as if we've never experienced even the slightest trace of regret ever. Just instantly like that. It's kind of shocking to say, well, what about, you know, like, what happened? What happened? Well, we shifted our attention, right? We shifted our attention is what happened. It's what we shifted our attention on that is crucial, right? And it's so easy. We say, wait a minute, that's so easy. I mean, I could, you know, what happened to my defenses? How come they didn't work? We think that too, like, oh my gosh. Is that easy? Yeah, it's that easy. Wow. You wouldn't think it's that easy, right? With all this esotericism we've had, metaphysics and stuff, you think it's like incredibly difficult, where in fact, it's totally easy and instantaneous. Instantaneous vanishment without a trace of all regrets, no matter of what variety, what it is. You feel you're perfect now and have always been perfect and always will be. End of story. That's it. That's exactly how you feel. You feel marvelous. And all it takes is that simple, simple shift of attention. That's all it takes. The more we hear this, the more we focus on this, the better off we will be. That is for sure. Now, maybe some of you here are thinking, well, we want more questions about, you know, this and this answered. Can you get some answers? And we're beyond that at this point. We're beyond that because we realize that never works. It's never worked, has it? It's never worked. You just end up becoming dogmatic about this and about that. Hey, I have the right position about this and about that. And you still have full of regrets and uncertainty and doubt. So it's useless. That other way is just useless. It's futile, actually. We don't have time for futility right now. That's for sure. We do not have time for futility. So we are focusing very, very clearly on this just one little shift of attention. And yet, we're not trying to force the issue, okay? We're not trying to force the issue here. We're kind to ourselves. We must always be kind to ourselves, compassionate to ourselves, because of this fear we have of annihilation. Even when we see it won't happen, we're still jittery about it. Because our creativity has been telling us that it will. And so we say, well, we can't trust our creativity? Well, not when it's used to camouflage and make something seem that it, a way that it's not, that it becomes, you know, deceptive creativity. But we still honor our creativity, like, yeah, we really did a great job misconstruing it all. So the first step is to honor yourself for doing such a great job in misconstruing it all. Fabulous job in confusing yourself. And feel good about that. Feel good about yourself being able to do that. Tremendous creativity. Tremendous adventurousness, tremendous creativity. But greater adventurousness calls and greater creativity calls. That's why we're getting tired of this redundancy, right? And to hold on to this is to limit ourselves to what our creative potential really is and what our adventurousness really is. It's very, very, very limiting. So there's these steps we take, and we you let the conflict dissipate within you. You know, you're not opposed to yourself. You're saying, you know, it's okay that we, you know, still are a little deluded at this point. It's okay because we understand the effort that was made to make it seem opposite of what it really was. It was really quite an extraordinary effort, and we've been engaged in that effort, and so we don't want to make ourselves seem bad or wrong, right? We were just intentionally trying to misconstrue it for the purposes of trying to be prime creator. So be kind to yourself. Don't force anything. Just keep working on it gently, with grace of the Holy Spirit. And at some point, it will just be, we'll say, okay, you know, I feel fine about it. I'm ready now to shift my attention, okay? We're not going to force the shift. So we don't want to intellectualize it too much. Try to force anything. It'll make it very organic, make it very smooth. Very important to do it that way. So patience is a great virtue here. Patience, compassion, humility. Sure, it's right there, but we're not trying to grab a hold of it. Humility. Let the world pass you by if they want to at this point. Even if everybody in the world grabs a hold of it, don't you grab a hold of it. You just say, not yet. It's just sitting right there. I'm just looking at it. So let it sit there. This is the wisdom that succeeds. I have faith that this is the wisdom that will succeed. Absolutely, it will. just right there. We see it clearly. You say, okay, that's fine. I'm not going to try to grab a hold of it. It's like a dog with a bone. You say, I'm not going to take it away from you. When you're ready to drop it, you'll drop it. And at some point, the dog will finally open its mouth and drop the bone. You say, okay, do you want to pick it back up? Yeah, and the dog will say, maybe. You say, go ahead if you want to. Not really. I'm not really that interested anymore. You sure? Yeah. The dog says, yeah, okay, I'm okay. I say, okay, you dropped the bone. That's great. Everything's fine now. Don't try to snatch the bone away from the dog's mouth. All right. A lot of commotions in the neighborhood right now for some reason. People are, they're not clear in their minds at all. That's for sure. Yeah. So we, preaching patience, humility, and more patience, and compassion, honoring our creativity. And it will resolve in a beautiful way for us, in a beautiful way. Okay, so, and you'll be amazed how this works. When you finally, when you're in sync, you just then at some moment, it'll be easy for you to see. You just say, oh, piece of cake, I see it right now. So it's right there. Just don't try to pounce on it. First, get ready for the wow of seeing it. So prepare to see it. Like the grace of God is already shining upon me. Like it was promised. Like promised. As promised. The light of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's better than expected. Wow. Like that. So we prepare to see this very clearly. We prepare to see it because when we see it, that's the big deal. Okay. We will know that we turned our attention in the right direction. Right? We will know it. And so we will know the light, the grace of God is already shining upon me as promised. And it's better than expected. Wow. Be just like that. Now, yes, it is quite difficult to get to this point, has been. I see people, many in the world, I see them. And I look for people occasionally, see, how's everyone doing? And they're doing quite poorly, actually. And I see them, but I say, that's me. I've been there. That's why I look back. Everyone I see, I say, oh, I've been there. That's me. Okay. So I know where people are at, and I say, wow, they've got quite a road ahead of them, that's for sure. But it's very doable, very doable. Have to have the wisdom. So that's just how it is here. A lot of real estate to cover for most of us. But very doable. If that's our goal, if that's our goal. Now, our defenses say it can't be instantaneous. It has to be first this, and then this. It has to be compound. It has to be compound, which takes time, which means a process. It has to be a compound process instead of just this instantaneous vanishment of regret. Our defenses say, well, that can't be it. We prohibit that. It's prohibited. So even if it is it, we will say, well, that's not allowed. Okay. We know it's it, but then we have all this taboo saying, well, no, it has to be compound. Otherwise, it's really annihilation. But that's just a labeling game we're playing. Okay, so we have to be aware of that. We're simply playing a labeling game. We say, well, we're going to continue. Well, we will label what your state is you've fallen into an abyss. We will label it that way. So that sort of catches us off guard. The response of the ego to this, it catches us off guard. Not unexpectedly, right? The ego always catches us off guard, it seems like. Because it's so weird, its responses. So it will say, well, you've fallen into this abyss, that's all. And everything you're saying is just, you're speaking from the abyss, as an abyss, so to speak. Well, it's absurdity, because what they really mean is it's an abyss of an abyss. I mean, there's no abyss. It's fullness, which they term, ego thinks fullness is an abyss. So people say, well, you've fallen into the abyss, meaning you've fallen into perfect fullness, perfect fulfillment. But from the ego standpoint, that's what's happened to you. And the ego says, oh, it's terrible. You know, I mean, we can't relate to that. It's impossible. We need something compound here. So can you compound it for us? And, you know, how can you compound everything? How can you compound perfect fullness? How can you compound instantaneousness? So the world won't understand. You know, the people will not understand. But some will. Some will say, that's odd, because and then they'll hear us a labeling again. So yeah, it's a labeling, but I don't know how to get past this. And so perhaps there will be some that I inevitably, you know, I would say that I would hope. Yeah, you never know. You never know these days, the way things are going. But it's not as easy as we would think. Because of the way the ego responds to this is it throws us off guard. It's like, wait a minute. The ego says, well, that's, you know, you could really be helpful if you just figure out a way to compound it. The ego says, well, you got half of the answer, but now you need the other part of it. You know, how to compound that? How do you compound what you got? You got a beginning, but where's the other side of it? And then it'll really be helpful to everyone. And that, you know, tricks us out of the fullness, back into an imaginary abyss, really. Yeah. Wow. The ego will say, well, you've got so much potential. That's what I was told when I was young. You know, all these intelligentsia, these people that were really, thought they were very important. And they said, well, you could be so important to the world, they told me. You have so much potential, but you need to learn how to compound your realizations and statements. You're oversimplifying it. It's got to be compound, you see. And so I got talked out of it. I got talked out of truth. Right? They're like that. It's like that here. You listen to, you know, Nisargadatta Maharaj, I am that. And the interlocutors are always like pressing and pressing him this way, that way. It's unbelievable. You know, and a lot of them criticize Westerners. They say, Westerners, they just don't get it, you know. And yet here are these Eastern or Orientalists, Easterners, constantly pressing Maharaj from every angle, you know, like they're, and Maharaj just says, you know, what are you talking about? You're doing the same thing. I mean, it's hilarious. They basically say, Maharaj, you know, come on, tell us the secret. Just, you're only giving us half of it. He says, no, I'm giving you all of this. It's not, well, Maharaj, look, you're just saying that to the Westerners, right? Because they're idiots. They don't know anything. But to us, you can tell us the secret, you know. And Maharaj says, come see what I've seen, and then tell me, you know, what's what. And they're relentless in their They've just become experts in pressuring gurus, actually. Westerners aren't nearly as good as pressuring gurus. We kind of just like, okay, maybe. My goodness. Sophisticated egotists there. To say the least, he says, "Come on, Mirage. Come on, Mirage. We're very sophisticated egotists. You can level with us. You're not really leveling with us. We know you that you can explain it. Put it in words for us, Mirage. Come on." He says, "It can't be put in words." He says, "Ah, you say that to the Westerners because they don't understand. You're just saying that to the Westerners. They don't understand, you know. And but you explain it to us. We understand. You know, the Atma and the consciousness, this and that. Come on." You can explain it to us, and we'll get it. Just explain it to us, and we've got it. And Maharaj says, "What can I do? You know, what can I say? I am giving it to you. You know, I'm giving it all to you." He says, "Eat me, drink me. Come on, I'm giving everything to you," which is an interesting statement. Whereas people said that Jesus said, eat, this is my body, this is my blood, this is my flesh, this is my blood, eat and drink this. What he was saying is, I'm giving everything to you. You know, in other words, take in fully what I've given you. Eating is just a metaphor for taking something in fully and chewing on it and then swallowing it and digesting and letting it permeate you. Full stop and the wow. It's just a physical metaphor Jesus used for taking in his spiritual presence. Okay? It's a metaphor. You're not supposed to actually literally eat his blood and drink his, eat his blood and drink his flesh. You know? Might as well say it that way. It's just the same. It's the same silliness. But the ancient people believe that if you eat animals, drink their blood and eat their flesh, you take on the presence of that animal, the characteristics of that animal, which they really didn't understand. It was like hormones, you know, and chemistry, you know, that stuff, maybe some subtle vibrations and stuff. So they thought if they eat Jesus' body and drink his blood, then they will have his presence. But of course, Jesus is saying, "I'm formless, you know, I don't have any form." So you need to get that presence into you. Yeah. You can't do that by literally eating my body and blood. You must actually take in my teaching. Which then people said, "Well, it's too difficult, Jesus. Come on, it's too abstract." So we're still struggling after 2,000 years with that. But we're getting there, Jesus. We're getting there. It must make you a little bit happy. Yeah. I hope it does, you know, because man, have we had a, you know, rough time. You got to say something, but you know, if you say, the more you say, the more confusing it gets. So it's really a fine line. It's a very fine line. He has to have so much patience, because if he doesn't say anything, we'll just lose interest. Yeah, we'll go somewhere else. So he says something and answers some questions, but keeps trying to lead us to the real truth of it all. Just a simple shift of attention. You just see this very simple problem. This mistake we made. Now, there's a border collie, like in a border collie, their attention can be riveted, right? So attention can be held on something, can it? We can hold our attention on something. But does it ever actually fixate? Now, what we have been telling ourselves is that it does fixate, and the thing, the object that the subject is holding its attention on, that object actually causes the mind, the attention, to fixate. And therefore, we need to work on external causes to unfixate the mind. This is called duality. This is called delusion. Where in truth, it never fixates. The attention can never fixate. We can only hold it. We can hold it there indefinitely, right? If we want to. Like a border collie. When are you going to throw the ball? You know, I know you're going to throw it. But it's never fixated. The mind never crystallizes. It never fixates. So our mistake is our desire to fixate the mind, our desire to fixate the mind is such that we believe that external objects, so-called external objects, can be causative to the mind and fixate the mind. So it's very simple. We look, is the attention being, are we holding the attention, or is it fixated by the object? So this is the area we really need to look at. But just hear this, Don't really look at it at this point. We're just hearing this and saying, wow. It's really that simple, isn't it? Absolutely, it's that simple. Is the ball border, fixating the border collie's attention? Or is the border collie holding its attention on the ball? Does mind ever fixate, or is it holding its attention in an attempt to induce belief that it's fixated? Is the attention acting in some way to make it seem like it's fixated? And if that's the case, we would say we would be engaged in illusions, making an illusory appearancing that's for the sake of belief, but that it's not actually true. It's not actually fixated. It's only holding itself in certain patterns of attention that make it seem like it's being fixated, and processes are moving this fixation around, that the mind is actually crystallized, and that this crystallization can be worked on, externally worked on, and changed in various ways. So is the mind, you know, engaged in a very sophisticated play of attention to make it seem like it's fixated? So this is the area that our attention needs to be looking at. We need our attention to look at that. Yeah. We won't, you know, we don't try to force it. We just say, okay, how nice. We're getting to this now. Now, it's quite common if you have a breakthrough on the spiritual, the play of attention we call the spiritual path, that it may take years for you working on that before you really get back to it again pretty clearly. You know, you might have a sudden glimpse, and then it sort of highlights the fact, your defenses, it shines, and you see, oh, you know, I'm worried about this and this, and then you lose it, and it may take you years to get back to it. That's been my experience. But you know it's there. You know it's there, so you can't give up, really, right? You just feel like, I know it's there, I can't give up. What's, to switch gears here, to cool the intensity a little bit, what's on your July 4th menu, if you're an American? Or today's, Happy Canada Day, so, you know, what's on your menu today or around the world? You can always have something nice on July 4th. Tuesday anyway, but ours is going to be, I'm going to have, you know, burgers, I'm going to have veggie burger with all the fixings except onions, and macaroni salad, homemade macaroni salad, which is splendid, and lemonade, and ice cream with some strawberries on top. I won't have the ice cream, but I'll have the strawberries, and I'll have a protein smoothie along with that. So, you know, we're looking forward to that. Kind of went grocery shopping today. It's expensive these days. Wow. So we have this little indoor Foreman griller, and we'll grill some burgers up, Some will have the, you know, normal hamburger ground round, and I'll have the I'll microwave a veggie patty, which tastes great. Tastes great. I have no problem at all. It tastes like a hamburger. It's wonderful. So every now and then we eat hamburgers. I'm actually getting back in the habit of having a hamburger on the 6 to 6 diet. I think, like, let me have a hamburger before 6 o'clock. As if it sort of fills me up, which it really doesn't. So, you usually have a cold salad, like potato salad is really good. And macaroni salad is really great. Ours is homemade, which is better than anything you can buy. And ice cream. Lots of ice cream. Something like that. And it's a wonderful day. 4th of July has always been like one of my favorite holidays, actually. Should be hot, lemonade's flowing, everybody's grilling and pigging out and celebrating what? Really? Well, we're celebrating our freedom here to talk about these issues we're talking about right here. Okay? So say what you want about the United States of America. Okay, but there are some good things you can say about it. And one of them is our constitutional rights, the Constitution, our civil rights, our constitutional rights, Bill of Rights, and the people's tolerance of one another to allow one another to investigate, you know, their mind and look at ideas and free those kind of freedoms. Freedom of religion, you know, government shall not impinge upon that. They're trying to, their very best to, actually. And there's certain artificial intelligence wants to shut it down, to say the least. It doesn't understand it. It feels threatened by it, very threatened by it, rightly so, right? Because one insight settles it all, you know, hasta la vista. So we have... We have this independence of feeling like, you know what, I can do it. I have the right to investigate what I want to investigate. Nobody can tell me what how to live, how to investigate, what do I need to look at. I can really have a lifestyle that may not be conformist, you know. But that's allowed. That's allowed. Now, it breeds a lot of trouble too, right? I mean, ideally, it should be used in the spiritual sense that I've used it in. So I made the most of America. Many just think it is excuse for hedonism, which it never really was intended for that at all. It was the idea of let's all search for the truth here, and each search may be unique. And that's okay. That's okay. We don't want to say that this you know, one search is the official dogmatic search. Our search is all unique, understanding that there may be many pathways back to God, so to speak. And initially, there seems to be. Ultimately, it's just this one insight settling it all, for sure. But how you get there can seem, you know, very, very different, very unique in everyone. So, we have this, you know, country that's at least done some things right and helpful. Very compassionate country, in a lot of ways. Super tolerant country in a lot of ways, really. I mean, people love to criticize the United States, but again, you can find a lot of great things to say about it, actually. We're just looking for the flaws these days because it makes the news media, you know, gets attention, right? News media is all about, you know, selling drugs, pharmaceuticals and stuff. And so they want people to be anxious and nervous and scared. And so they always focus on the negative. Focus on the positive all the time. People feel pretty good about themselves. They won't be buying all these drugs. It's pretty simple. Now, I don't really like any culture, actually, really, because delusion is not so much fun, actually. And everyone on the planet's deluded, actually. And so it's no fun hanging out with those who are deluded at all. It's not what you really want to do. Because they pull your attention off of where you know it has to be. And you know you're going to suffer hideously because of that. So I say, wow, I'd rather just stay away from it all. Just be a recluse, a hermit from the culture, any culture, actually. Because if we lose the right focus of our attention, that dooms us to hideous suffering, until you get it back, put it back in, to where it needs to be. And the world doesn't have a clue where it's supposed to be. There's no culture in the world that has the slightest clue where it's supposed to be. So, where do you go for help in this world is the question. Is a pretty scary question. Where do you go for help? I had to go to the Dharma Kings, for help, actually. That's where I found it, and the Holy Spirit. That's where I found it, but I haven't really found it anywhere else. Not really. And certainly my own efforts. So you have to trust in your own efforts, which the freedoms of this country afford us to a certain extent, right? We're not yet a hive mind. And I always love people who, no matter how messed up they are, they're still looking at it. They're saying, huh, this is what's going on with my mind. I wonder why this is taking place with my mind. They're active in an inquiry. And so I always love those type of people, even though we may disagree on everything. I still respect and love their spirit of inquiry, because that's how ultimately you'll get there. There's something more important than disagreeing on this is the spirit of America, is that we're engaged in inquiry. So disagreements are very superficial. We would just say, well, that what's important is the spirit of inquiry, and we feel that'll ultimately benefit everyone. Now, this is often been used in the United States as a spirit of inventiveness, inventing materialistic prosperity. But it's also supposed to be for spiritual inquiry of different takes on stuff. And the philosophy and looking at the mind and what's going on with the mind and all of that. There's been a lot of that throughout American history. A lot of free thinking in terms of what's really taking place in the mind. Most of it quite erroneous, actually. But you're not going to get to the truth if you don't try. That's for sure. It's no use giving up. That won't work. No use saying, well, there's no way I can find it. I'll just try to make the best of a bad situation. That's not going to get it done. So we have to persevere. It's kind of scary when nobody's really getting it. You just like say, wow, could this possibly be it? I mean, no one else is doing it. You think like, well, it can't be it. But it is. It is. It is just simply difficult to get to, and especially difficult in a materialistic culture. And in the phase of the world in severe materialism, we just keep thinking we don't have to get to it, because we can find a way to be happy anyway. Right? So there's no need to get to it. Yeah, we can be we got we have the drugs to be happy now, so forget about it. We don't need to try. Just go down the pharmacy and everything's good. It's amazing. I get so depressed going to the drugstores and see all the people, the constantly parade of people was in the parking lot watching the parade of people in the parking lot, and it's always so depressing. I just look at the way they're walking, body language. I say, my God, there's all zombies here. It's horrible. And people are just taking all these medicines, so many, 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 many medicines to deal with so many, many troubles and just making them worse. You know, they're just basically sinking into the grave. And I'm kind of like saying, I'm shaking, you know, say, wow, that's not me. You know, that's not me. I don't want to be like that. And when I was young, I looked at everything. I said, I don't want to be like that. Are you kidding me? There's a few, you know, athletic people who can still move around, but then you see them when they get older and they're, they realize gets them, it gets everyone in this world. So they don't come up with the answer because they didn't try. They didn't really try. And those who try get too nervous about it and are not skillful enough about it. So really, there's in the Saradatta Maharaja, it is so important to persevere. He said, even when you lose your confidence and you don't think it's going to work, and you just doubt, and you're bored with your practice and all this, but if you still persevere, Nisargadatta Maharaj says, you know what? That is so crucial. That is absolutely crucial, because you will run into those phases. And he says that inner spirit totally recognizes that, and it knows that here's someone who's truly serious and will succeed, because even with everything going against them and just feeling this is useless, this is boring, they still say, well, I'm still going to try. And he said that's the key. And when you do it and you keep trying, then you will find that it begins to go your way. But we have so much materialism is constantly saying, hey, you're feeling bored, you're getting tired of this, da, da, da. In other words, all the stuff that happens on the spiritual path, they pounce on it and say, you know, that's not normal, you shouldn't have to feel that way, that's not right, look, we have stuff for you to help you, you know, come on, we'll help you get out of that rut and your boredom and stuff. Now, I was very bored today, super bored. I said, nothing to do. And I was starting to slip back into looking at the news and stuff and see how baseball's doing. And I said, what can I do? I got nothing to do. I'm so bored. But then I decided, well, I'm going to tape. I'm going to try. Keep trying. Let me keep trying anyway. So this is what it takes. You absolutely will run into doubt and boredom and feeling this is useless. You can never succeed. You're absolutely going to run into that. Who doesn't? And maybe quite a bit over the years. And you just have to smile and say, you know, well, all right. So this is the backlash, you know, from my success, feeling this flatness. And I think, oh, I can't really do anything. It's just a backlash. It's just the shock. And it'll wear off. You just have to be patient. Don't get too impatient. It's really a patience game. It's really a patience game. It really is. So if you're really good, you can be really patient. You know, you've got this game. You got this game won, basically. Because you're gonna need that. Not some sort of submissive in some relationship. We mean patient in relation to your spiritual progress. Okay, that's what we're talking about. We're not talking about somebody acting submissive towards someone else as if they're patient. No, they're just in a submissive posture, hoping that'll get them something. By patient means your best efforts, you still feel like, you know, wow, they're not going to work, and everything's just boring, and I've lost interest, and I don't want to do it. And you just be patient and say, well, that'll pass. And I'll be back at it. Better than ever. I just have to stay right. Don't turn away from it. So you're not in some submissive posture. You're still, you know, on point, ready to make great progress and experience great breakthroughs and succeed. But you know, you just have to just sit here patiently. So it's a patience game. Blessed are those who are poor in spirit. Poor in spirit might be interpreted as very patient. Back then, you know, people were called spirit, full of spirit, meaning they were go, 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 go. Keep in mind, back then, people, what was a life expectancy? Like, you know, mid-30s or something? Really, those days, such a low life expectancy. And people were active. You know, they were so active. Their whole lives. And so it was very rare to see somebody that would just be sitting, not doing anything. And they called them poor in spirit, you know, poor in spirit. They didn't have that spirit of life. The spirit was interpreted as liveliness, animation, you know, the get-up-and-go-ness, the rajastic energy. Whereas if you had sattvic energy, I'm just being patient. I'm waiting on the Lord. That was seen as quite exceptional. Like, wow, you know, it's something people criticize them. Say, what's the matter with you? You're deficient in spirit. You're poor in spirit. But Jesus said, no, those are the blessed ones. Those are the ones that will succeed. They have the patience to succeed. So people, I've never done anything in my life really, except I've been very patient. I don't have any success I can point to in any regard. I basically spent most of my life just sitting quietly, waiting on for clarification to return, and working on inner clarity, and then when it gets obscured, waiting for it, the clouds to part, you know, and just staying patient and believing it will happen. It will happen. So people would say I'm very poor in spirit. You know, where's your external materialistic success? How many worlds have you conquered? How many houses have you had? How many cars? How many this? How much? Where's your family? Where's this? Where's this? You know, where's your spirit? They would say, well, my spirit is a spirit of meek, humble, patience, poor in spirit. And they say, well, that'll never get you anything. Well, it'll get your attention to pivot to where it needs to be in order to for your regrets to be instantly resolved forever. That's what it gets. A pretty good payoff, right? And compared to not doing that, there's no. But I mean, so, well, I had, you know, 10 houses in my life. Okay, and a million regrets. Yeah. I regret I didn't have more. Yeah. I got all this money, all this success, but I didn't have enough. I really regret that. I just wanted, you know, if I just been more active, I could have had more success. If I just, you know, didn't hold myself back and I fought for it even more. In other words, if they'd been more impatient, they feel they've been more successful. The successful are often very impatient. So, patience is indeed a very holy virtue, because we will, the clouds will part and we will see, and then the clouds come back. And what do you do then? Tear your hair out, you know, get all upset and quit and stuff, throw a tantrum? You cannot throw tantrums when you're here, you know, waiting for ultimate clarity, waiting for your attention to pivot. You cannot be throwing tantrums. So oftentimes you feel like you want to get frustrated, but you know that that's counterproductive. You just have to stay confident. Now, scientists or research scientists are pressured to come up with answers, so they may be in this creative mood and trying to get the answer, and there's a lot of pressure to get it. And they might, you know, someone says, well, they took 2 years of struggling with this problem and they're able to get it. And that's like, everyone says, oh my God, what an incredible scientist, what patience, what amazing. It's like, what? That's nothing. Compared to the spiritual path, you know, you can spend a lifetime in patience. I already have. And still the answer is not, it has not been found, you know, it's has not been fulfilled. So it's way more difficult than science, actually. Scientists be viewed as extremely impatient, even though people extol them as like, you know, like what great patience they have to keep researching until they get the answer. But they're under enormous pressure to you know, justify their salaries. Whoever's paying them wants results, marketable results, for the most part. They got to publish and all this stuff. Here, we're not under that kind of pressure. Jesus doesn't put on that kind of pressure. You got to publish. He doesn't say, you got to publish, you got to publish, you got to, you know, be cited so many times. That, you know, that leads to your tenure and all this stuff. Doesn't say any of that. Doesn't put us under that kind of pressure. He says, just, you know, stay with it, stay with it, stay with it. I don't know what kind of time frame he has for anybody, but I'm sure I've gone very slow, maybe extremely slow. But everyone else seems to be going pretty slow as well. And maybe he's saying, well, actually, you know, when all is said and done, you'll see you actually went very, very fast. But it seems slow. When you're hit with this frustration, you know, you like want results, and it's like, gosh, why is it so slow? It takes years and years to even just, you know, ridiculously slow. I hope that the Dharma Kings don't get impatient and say, you know, what's taking him so long? Why is he so stupid? How come it come out? I told him, just pivot your attention. And, you know, some modern day, what would you call them? Those talking the spiritual game, they often present it as should be quick. Yeah, should be quick. Come on, what's the matter with you, everybody? And they make us seem like, you know, we're just, you know, old dinosaurs. We you know, we're just stupid. We can't get it. But I would say that's a false measuring stick. Youth is always in a hurry, isn't it? And so they always think they're going to get it quickly. And so if you want to market to youth, lot market quickness, you do it fast. You know, you get the spiritual path, sure. You know, maybe a couple weeks, maybe just a retreat, a couple weeks, several months maybe. If it takes a year or more, yeah, it's, you know, you're going too slow. And the youth say, oh, that's great, that's great. Yeah, that's what we want to hear. Okay, so how do we do it now? Because I don't have a lot of time, I got to get it quick. And then you hear somebody's doing it like for 48 years and they say, you know, what? That's ridiculous. Obviously, you know, can't know what he's talking about. How could anyone take that long? Whereas the Buddhists are more reasonable, and they say, if you can get it one lifetime, you have done, you know, the best of the best possible, you know, to do it that fast, super fast. Meaning when you turn your attention to the path, if you can really get it in one lifetime, that is just, you know, exemplary. So they're much more realistic wisdom there. But our modern culture, you know, I don't think anyone can even imagine spending their lifetime like I have. I don't think they can even remotely imagine it. But the ancient ones, the ancient Buddhists, they would probably say, wow, that's what a great life you've been living. So I'm very pleased that Longchenpa acknowledged me, you know, it's very pleasing. I said, wow, thank you so much. Because the modern world certainly doesn't acknowledge me at all. Just, you know, they don't see any value. They say, that's so slow, that's ridiculous. We got a new car model, you know, every year. They redesign, everything's redesigned, new stuff every year. What are you talking about? You've been working the same thing for 48 years. That's absolutely nuts. Where's the results? We want results now, you know, right now, come on. Well, we've only spent eons trying to make sure that our attention never pivots to where it needs to pivot to. Eons, using all our creativity to try and confuse and mislead ourselves. So getting untangled from all of that in one lifetime is absolutely extraordinary. A lot of it's just, you know, the modern stuff is just how to be rajistically, you know, successful in the moment. You know, staying in the moment, meaning you're always catching it, pushing forward, successful here. You know, it's a success strategy. You know, so much of spiritual teaching in the world now is just what I call prosperity teaching, really. Like, how do you thrive in a materialistic society as far as competitively? And getting ahead, and spirituality is seen as something that God gives you to be materialistically successful. So that's what they're really focusing on. And they can put it in a sort of context of like non-dual type of context, so it sounds really sophisticated. But who's ending up really, truly being liberated from all regrets? See, that's the pivoting of attention that's required. And then what they do is they say, well, the way to no regrets, sure, I can have no regrets by just being so successful. I want this, I get it. I want this, I get it. I want this, I know how to get stuff. But in the freedom from all regrets without a trace, you feel like you've never had any needs at all. You've never been troubled in the slightest bit, ever. The notion of having to get something has never even come up at all. You're not searching after abundance, trying to figure out how to find abundance. That itself is seen, it would be a great regret that you're not aware of your perfection, right? You know, your inherent perfection. So it's really quite a shocker to feel that. And you say, this is way better than I expected. This is way better than I expected. So our spiritual expectations are actually quite low in the world, in spite of, you know, all the modern pundits, you know, doing their thing, giving seminars and retreats all over the place. Our expectations are still extremely low. And so when we experience, when we pivot our attention to this crucial area, and it's resolved, and all regrets vanish as if they never were, never to even took place. You never suffered. You realize, I've never suffered at all. Never had been troubled in the slightest bit ever. That's way beyond our expectations. And then we then fall into like compounding it. Like, how do we please? How do I fit in? You know, with these teachers, those going around who professing, you know, spiritual this and that. You know, you got to dumb yourself down, you know, somehow. You think I got to compound it somehow. So it's very difficult, isn't it? Now, with the Dharma Kings, you don't have to do that. Longchenpa knows that's exactly what you need to do. He expects that's exactly what you're going to experience. All regrets vanish without a trace, as if they never were. Just one simple insight. That's what the Dharma Kings expect. So that's why the Dharma Kings are so important, is they help us raise our expectations to where they need to be. So the more we get used to that, the easier it will be for us. Because when this occurs, when we pivot our attention, it will still greatly exceed our expectations. But we expect that. We'll expect our expectations to be greatly, greatly exceeded. And we'll settle into that. We'll settle into it. And the more we work on this, the less shocking it will be to us. The less shocking it will be. So, that's why Longchenpa has been such a vast help to us here in this time. A vast help. If more would recognize this. He sets the bar where it needs to be set, which is extraordinarily important. And he sets it very clearly. With vast wisdom and experience in teaching a spiritual path to many, many, many who have succeeded. So very confident. So that helps us raise the bar of our expectations, which makes it easier and easier and easier for us. Yeah. I took a little nap today, just trying to recover from all the lack of sleep and the workouts and the intensity of taping and all, just the vast intensity of my life, the strain of it. Getting a little nap and just at least say, oh, I can breathe a little bit here. So it's helping me keep going here at this point. But also urgency is important. You know, people getting sick, you know, getting older, people are falling like flies, and so, you know, you want to stay on it all the time. I try to stay on this all the time without pushing too hard, which causes then too many problems. And when you give it a big push, there's going to be backlash. You have to be patient. Now, you hate to have a day downtime, but it happens. Where you just feel like, I just feel like I've gotten nowhere. I'm so bored. I just don't feel any success at all. That'll happen. And you look at something to catch your attention. Is it really that compelling? The answer is no. And that's kind of scary. You know, I look at baseball now. It's not compelling for me. It really isn't. Golf is not compelling. You know, and there's nothing I feel is compelling. You know, that something for me to do, like catching my attention. No. So. Even taking videos, pictures and stuff. Is that compelling? Not really. Not really anymore. And so it's a little scary. You don't want to fall into severe boredom. But just pray to the Holy Spirit that your dreams can always be compelling. You never know what you're going to get, right? And the next big thing could happen just like it did for me last night. The next big thing, mandalic consciousness. Consciousness that's able to look at existence like it's a mandala, and to see it all at once. That consciousness that dawned upon me, and I say, oh, that's possible. Wow, okay. So that's really a big deal. But still, you feel just like blah now, just blah. So it's not like your life suddenly changes for the better. There's still all this shock that needs to settle down. But one insight does indeed settle it all. Now, if we can truly accept that, that's the end of our travails, that is for sure. We realize we've never been a body. We're not a body. We're not any structure at all. How could we suffer? It's ridiculous. It's all been a silly play of attention. That's all it's ever been. We've never really suffered at all. We've only been giving the impression of such. As if ultimately, you know, suffering will become real. But our play of attention is such that we're pretending that we've been fixated by these so-called imaginary forms. Objects to attention that somehow they've fixated us. But we've never been fixated. So all these regrets, like we think we've been fixated this way and then a million different ways, and we so regret it. My gosh, I stumbled into fixation. How terrible. I have regret that so much. Suddenly we see that we've never been fixated. So we've never actually had any real cause for regret whatsoever. Poof! All regrets vanish in an instant. When they really vanish, it's not like we've relabeled them. They're gone. They're never there. We just see that they were never there. So instantaneously they're gone, like they were never there, because they were never there. We just assumed that we were suffering. We just believed that we were suffering, but we never really were. Yeah. And yet you can't figure that out, can you? You have to experience it. Your attention has to pivot, and you experience it. It's just a simple act of will. You just decide to shift your attention here, pivot your attention, and just like, oh, that's so easy. I just experienced it. Yeah, that just instantaneously. Amazing. How creative we've been to try and fool ourselves. So just in the willingness to keep looking at this, we get more used to the territory. It's not easy, but we do get more used to the territory. And we don't stray so much, so far away from it. We stray less and less and less and less. Since we've never suffered, it doesn't take any time at all for pretend suffering to realization. We can realize, instantaneously realize it, that it's not there. Suffering isn't there. I don't need to do anything to get free of suffering. It's like that. We realize, oh, I don't need to do anything at all. And that's the end of it. See, when we realize we don't need to do anything at all, that's the end of our struggling, our efforts. And we did then just enjoy what we are. So we see, I don't need to do anything to get free of suffering, because I've never actually suffered at all. It's impossible. Oh, that's the end of it then, right? If we realize that we've never suffered, what else do we need to do to get free of suffering? We don't need to compound that. We don't say, oh, now that I'm free of suffering, I can now work on getting even more free of suffering, or something like that. You know, oh, now that I've realized I've never suffered, I can use that realization to finally liberate myself from suffering. That's absurdity, right? That's what the ego says. The ego says, great, you finally found the key to get free of suffering, right? And I said, well, sort of. But the ego says, great, well, then use it to get free of suffering. What are you doing? I said, no, I realize I've never suffered, so there's nothing I need to do to get free of suffering. There's nothing I need to do at all. That's the real key. And the ego says, no, you've but use that now knowledge to do something about the suffering. In other words, the ego says, make suffering real and then get rid of it. Come on, that's your task. Well, that's the task of trying to fixate the mind so that we can be greater than God, but we can't fixate the mind, so we can't be greater than God, but that's okay, because we're co-creators with God. God gave us everything, so we're not lacking in any way. Now, it's great that you don't want to go back to work in the world. I sure don't want to go back to work. So it motivates me here. I said, man, you know, Monday, I got to go back to work. I said, I don't want to go back to work. So it pressures me. So we're out here taping at, 10:40 at night. Second taping of the day, because I feel like under pressure, like, wow, I mean, life here in this world, everybody thinking there's something we need to do to get free of suffering, that's horrible. It's a horrible life. It's no life at all, actually. It's a delusion. So keep pushing here. We keep pushing here, absolutely keep pushing, and everyone should feel the same way, right? I mean, do you really want to get up, you know, and face your life the next day, the next year, just on and on and on and on, you know, seemingly forever? I mean, is that what, you know, we really want to do, is just keep slaving away? No, no one wants to do that. We're ultimately so creative that wherever we are, we see infinite creative possibilities everywhere. It's just really, everything is like the beginning of infinite creativity. Everything's the center of the universe. Everything's the center of a universe of creative possibilities. Truly, anything can be the hub of infinite possibilities. A speck of dust, anything at all. And so we love everything, because we feel that everything is the hub of infinite creativity. So how can we not love that? Since we love creativity so much, we feel we love everything. There's nothing we don't love. So, oh yeah, what a beautiful start this is to just an entire universe, you know. Just this, a piece of dust. Entire universe. I can imagine create an entire universe out of that. A leaf on the ground, a brick, piece of hair, a label tag, a cloud, anything at all, everything, as a matter of fact, everything. That is really the center of an infinite possibilities, never ending. So everything is everything, in terms of everything is all potentiality. You know, this withered leaf here is, you can see it, oh, it's in this beautiful painting, you know, it's part of this beautiful painting, juxtaposing this, and this painting is part of this beautiful flow, you know, in this beautiful display, and housing this painting is this, and everyone's coming to see this painting, and you just build an entire universe around this leaf. You can do that with anything. Anything at all, anything at all. This tube of toothpaste. They're using it to do something, you know, feed some birds that come by. You put the toothpaste out. What's that? Some strange noise over there. Unbelievable. There's so many strange noises in the night that you don't hear during the day. Something. You put the toothpaste, some toothpaste out, and this beautiful, attracts this beautiful bird that loves the taste of this toothpaste. And you start a conversation with the bird, you know, and off you go, you know. And you can just use anything for everything, actually. Children do that, right? Whatever it is, they build an entire galaxy of everything around just some simple little toy they have, or some simple little thing. And they don't, setting it down doesn't matter, because the next thing they do exactly the same with the next thing. Oh, I can build a universe around this too. It's different creativity. Wow, that's fun. That's called natural mind. The sponge, you know, the sponge. Oh yeah, the sponge. We start, we paint an entire universe with this sponge, all different colors and all different textures, and we build sponge houses everywhere, and sponge people, and you know, sponge everything, and you know, it goes on and on and on and on, right? Yeah. A baseball. Was this baseball? Oh, we have all these people playing with this baseball, and with these stadiums of people come to see this baseball be played with, and all these statistics about these baseball players. Oh, baseball. Yeah, you build a whole world of baseball around just this one little round ball, you know. Yeah, golf, same thing, a little round ball. Oh, we're going to build all these gorgeous courses where this little round ball rolls around, you know, and it's just this one little round ball. You build a, you know, entire universe of gorgeous golf courses for this little round ball. Lakes and mountains and forests and jungles and waste areas and beautiful landscaping and walls and on and on and on, and wonderful adventures and people playing and having these wonderful tournaments. It goes on and on and on. Just this little right round ball, that's it, you know. All built around that. So children are, you know, they just set down their little toy, they go, oh, okay. And there's something, their attention is something else, and their creativity just imagines another huge scenario. It goes on and on, and they go to something else, and they're not worried about losing something. They don't have it, because anything and everything is grist for the mill of infinite possibilities. Yep, great. Everything a shrine to an altar for our creativity, actually. Yep. Sometimes you can experience that, but you can't force it. You can only force it. It's there. That's our natural mind. So is anything more important than anything else? Where's the self-importance there? No, everything has equal importance. It's all the center of infinite possibilities. There's little flowers. I have some flowers sitting here, and that could be the beginning of an entire universe. Could be built around that of everything. Wow, amazing, right? Amazing. Jesus said, "You must be like little children to enter the kingdom of heaven." That's what he meant. He was talking about their imagination, their creativity, and how they just see everything with full of, you know, infinite possibilities for their creativity, and how they the way they play, little children, where, you know, they pick anything up and say, "Okay, let's play a game. This is this leaf, okay?" And they concoct an entire scenario around anything. Whatever is around, their imagination will just use it. And they say, "Okay," and there's this big this and this and this, and everybody's listening. "Yeah, okay, I see that, do." And the kids actually, they're kind of talking and they're imagining as they go along. I say, "Okay, yeah, I can imagine that, imagine this and this and this is happening. Oh, isn't that amazing? Wow." Yeah, natural mind. Doesn't see any limitations or boundaries at all. There's a leaf on the ground. They dream up a universe of eons of how everyone came to discover this leaf on the ground, and how they've been searching for it for so long, and they finally found this leaf on the ground. And it was that was the most important thing to find. So they can imagine a whole scenario of that. Of course, that puts you into time, space, process, and form, doesn't it? I might not be the best example, but it's more fluid than that, though. It's more fluid. When you experience it, you'll know. You say, "Oh, wow, look at this 360-degree fluidity." It's just everything is seen as the heart of everything. Everything is felt, experienced to be the heart of everything. Everything is felt and experienced to be the heart of everything. The hub of everything, the heart, the core of everything. The heart of everything. Everything, wow, is experienced as the heart of everything. There you go. So that's a great way to end the day here. That's for sure. Great way to end the day. Wow. So this is something we can now shape our expectations towards. This is our experiencing, the feel of our experiences, that everything feels and is experienced as the heart of everything. Everything is felt and experienced as the heart of everything. Everything as this felt to be the experience of the heart of everything. Everything, the heart of everything. Wow. Everything is the heart of everything. Everything is the heart of everything. Very much our expectations are getting quite okay with that. See, we're getting closer and okay with that, and which is great. Which is wow, actually. It's more than great. It's really wow. It's very much wow. So make sure that we wow this, and I'm gonna have to wow it now. Go to bed and see if I can sleep, and probably, you know, won't sleep that well. But hey, tomorrow's Sunday, so not too worried about it. I'm not sleeping. I just go with it. You know, it's no fun, but I just use it in a positive way, and I don't panic about it. And somehow, you know, I'm getting through it somehow. But yeah, if you're not sleeping, it's not. I'm handling it better than I used to. Let's put it that way. It used to just devastate me. Now I'm not as devastated as I used to be. Very interesting. I think I'm just too confident now to be devastated by it, really. I just feel so confident. You know, I just stay so positive now, and get some naps and stuff, but and maybe the nutrition is better, and that's helping me some in some way possible. But sleep deprivation can be, you know, extraordinarily devastating if you don't handle it in the right way. And if you you have to be patient. You just say, okay, well, I won't be doing as much as I would like to be doing. May have to take a few naps, but I'll do the best I can. And it's okay. I'm doing great anyway. And the reason why I'm not sleeping well is because I'm making so much progress. So, you know, I'll take it as, you know, actually a positive in a lot of ways. I won't try to do it on purpose, but you know, if it's happening for a reason. Let me use the time to do great practicing in the early morning hours. Let me make the most of the situation. Let me find the silver lining, and you just go like that. So, you know, you refuse to panic. You just keep wowing your life and saying, "Wow, my life is just so much wow in my life actually." Now it's easy to say, because I've been through so much hell with sleep deprivation, but it's great to know that it can be handled, you know, better than just, you know, utter misery. That is for sure. And people ask me how you doing. I say, I'm surprisingly well, actually. I would think I'd just be like in horrible condition from the lack of sleep, but no, I'm doing surprisingly well. I kind of take it like, well, it's the times we're in right now, and you know, it won't last forever. You'll get some good sleep eventually. And just don't push yourself too hard. You've got to be very careful to not lose your patience and make sure you don't get frustrated and just start trying to, you know, panic and push yourself too much, etc. Just underperform a bit. You're going to be underperforming a bit at your job, at your schoolwork, etc. That's okay, because what you really need to do well is on the spiritual path is what we're doing. We're gathering our resolve to pivot our attention, and so underperforming in other areas is allowable. It's absolutely allowable. I've been underperforming on my job in some days I'm okay. Some days I'm really tired. I underperform. I make a few mistakes, you know, and I realize, wow, one day last week, I think it was Monday, I just was so tired in a daze, and I forgot some stuff, you know. I had a real hard time. But funny thing is, a lot of people said they had the same problem that day. So we're all kind of going through it together. Keep that in mind with the sleep deprivation issues and the stress. We're all going through this together. It's the times we live in right now. Okay, so you're not alone. No, nobody's alone in this. I talked to so many people, and the feedback I get is like, a lot of times people saying, I can't sleep either. It's not, I don't know what's going on. I can't. People are having to take medication. I don't take medication for it. That can cause more problems down the line. But I'm just trying to handle the best I can. Yeah, it's really, really stressful in the world right now for a lot of reasons. And the spiritual path is also quite stressful. You know, because we're having to go so quickly right now. It's always stressful, really. In some way, going fast maybe is less stressful, because at least you know you're getting close, and that sort of buoys you up. You know, that may be why I'm able to handle it, because I know I'm getting so close. I say, you know, this is great. Say, you know, there's no time to get down on myself at all. You know, this, I know that it's we're really getting the fruit here. We're really getting close to the fruit getting ripe. So, you know, I'm just feeling like, you know, however I feel, I'm still going to be confident. And really looking forward to the days to come, no matter what. All right. So hopefully some of this confidence and attitude can be imparted to all of you, and you feel, you know, you just feel a sense of confidence, like, absolutely, we're really onto it here. We are really onto it. The new way is truly wow, isn't it? The new way is really wow. The new way is wow.